Before we begin, I'd like to thank Ubisoft for providing me with access to this game. It has been 3 years since the last entry in Assassin's Creed, but now the next chapter in Ubisoft's biggest franchise is finally here, with Assassin's Creed Mirage, which marks a departure from the massive open-world action RPG of the last three entries to a more compact map with a stealth-focused gameplay. And on the technical side, the game is built using the same engine and technology as EC Valhalla, which is not particularly a bad thing, because it retains a lot of key advantages of the AnvilNext 2 engine, like the stunning indirect lighting and global illumination, great looking volumetric effects, and highly detailed environments. But there are some flaws, particularly when it comes to the character's animation and facial expressions. And the biggest issue, in my opinion, is the extensive use of chromatic aberration, which negatively impacts the clarity of the game's visuals. And currently, there is no setting to disable it. And speaking of settings, on one hand, the game offers similar graphics menu to EC Valhalla, with preview images and a description that shows and explains the effect of each setting, which is great. But on the other hand, a lot of settings requires a complete restart of the game, which makes tweaking these settings quite frustrating. That's why in this video, as usual, we'll examine the game's graphics settings to see the effect of each one on the visuals and the performance. So let's get started. Let's kick off with image quality, and for that the game offers a lot of options. We have of course TAA, in addition to DLSS, FSR and even DP4A XeSS, and each one can be used for upscaling or for anti-aliasing at native resolution. So let's start with native resolution. Here at this scene we can see that DLSS at native or DLAA has the cleanest image with almost no shimmering, unlike FSR2 and TAA, and XeSS also looks great, albeit slightly softer compared to DLSS. And for upscaling when using quality mode, we see the same results. DLSS produces the best image quality, with XeSS closely trailing behind. And both TAA and especially FSR2 exhibit noticeable aliasing. So here, if you have an RTX GPU, use DLSS or DLAA, and if not, consider using XeSS. But if you get low performance with XeSS, use TAA. Next we have world details. This setting controls the geometric level of detail, and with higher options we get more geometry and more visible objects in a distance, as you can see here. And performance wise, when GPU bound, going from low to medium costs 3%, to high 5%, very high 11%, and ultra high 13%. But when CPU bound, the gap between each option is a little bit larger, as going from low to medium and high costs 7%, to very high 15%, and to ultra high 18%. So for this one, I recommend high. Clutter density controls the density of smaller objects and ground details, and it's more noticeable on small grass and rocks, like here. And it doesn't affect thicker grass or foliage. And this setting has negligible performance impact. So here, since high and very high look almost identical, I recommend high just to stay on the safe side. Moving on to shadows, this one controls the resolution and quality of both close and distant shadows. And on the performance side, going from low to even very high has negligible impact, but going to ultra high costs around 7%. However, very high and ultra high enable dynamic shadows from dynamic lights like this torch. And during these moments, the performance impact of very high and ultra high is much bigger, as you can see here, with around 10% to very high and 12% to ultra high. So for this one, I recommend high, and if you have enough performance to spare, use very high to enable dynamic shadows. Volumetric clouds, as the name suggests, controls the resolution and quality of these clouds, and this is one of the most demanding settings in this game. Here we can see that medium and high perform almost identical, but going to very high costs an additional 5%, and to ultra high 28%. So here I recommend high volumetric clouds. Next we have water. This setting controls the quality of both water surface and underwater effects. So with higher options, you'll see better water simulation effects and better refraction, like here. An underwater dehigh option allows more light to penetrate water surfaces, which produce underwater light shafts. And on the performance side, on the surface, this setting has negligible performance impact. However, underwater in some areas like here, going from low to high can cost around 6%. So here, since you'll spend most of the time on the surface, I recommend keeping the setting at high. Screen space reflections comes with a simple toggle on or off, which enable or disable these reflections. And on the performance side, enabling SSR costs around 3%. So here I highly recommend keeping SSR enabled, because without these reflections, most water and reflective surfaces look flat, which can negatively impact the visual presentation. Moving on to textures, here we have two settings. The first one is environment textures, and surprisingly this setting has a performance impact, where going from low to ultra high can cost around 3%, and the ultra high option here almost hit the VRAM limit of my GPU, but during normal gameplay I can assure you that I had no problem using ultra high textures at native 1440p with DLAA. The second setting is character textures, and this one also has a small performance impact, around 2% from low to high, with a smaller impact on the VRAM compared to environment textures. Next we have depth of field. This effect is mostly noticeable during cutscenes and conversations, and it can also appear during assassinations. And performance wise, going from low to medium costs around 2% and to high 4%. And lastly, we have adaptive quality. This one, when enabled, can dynamically change the internal resolution to maintain the performance at the desired frame rate of 30, 45, or 60 FPS. For example, here I am running the game at 1440p with 130% resolution scaling, and as you can see, the performance is nowhere near 60 FPS. And if I enable adaptive quality with 60 FPS target, we can see that the game now is running around 60 FPS. But the issue here is that sometimes the performance goes slightly above or below 60, which can cause a lot of frame time spikes and stuttering. And even if I change the refresh rate to 60Hz with VSync on, the performance still goes below 60 FPS and the frame time now is better, but it's still not great. So for now, I don't recommend using adaptive quality. Instead, if you need more performance, use the upscaling options. Now, based on everything we saw so far, these are my recommended settings. Let's now compare optimized settings and ultra presets at native 1440p with 130% resolution scaling on both sides. And here in this area, we can see that optimized settings can offer around 38% boost to performance. But this is the best case scenario and will not always be the case, as in other areas the difference is smaller, like here with 21%, and it can even get smaller than that. So the performance scalability of the settings in this game is not particularly strong. Therefore, if you need more performance, I would advise against further reducing the settings. Instead, consider using DLSS or XeSS. And with that, we arrive at the end. Thank you so much for watching and for your time. If you enjoyed the video, leave a like, and if not, leave a dislike. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell for future videos, and hopefully I'll see you all in the next one.